Good afternoon. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Psalm 73. Psalm 73. We'll read quite a bit out of this passage of Scripture. Entitled this message tonight, Pondering Thoughts Today, Stumbling Blocks Tomorrow. Pondering Thoughts Today, Stumbling Blocks Tomorrow. Psalm 73, verse 1 says, Truly, God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. The word clean there is of a pure heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covers them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness, and they have more than a heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression, and they speak lawfully. They set their mouths against the heavens, and their tongues walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out of them. And they say, How doeth God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily have I cleansed my hands in vain, and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastised every morning. If I say, I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. Put your finger right here in verse 17. It says, Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I therein. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, as we bow our heads this wondrous afternoon, dear God, Lord, I can't help but just glory and marvel at your grace and your mercy. Lord, this day we want to lift you up. This day we want you to be proclaimed. This day we pray that you are glorified. Help us, Lord, to see what you'd have us to know out of your word this day. And we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In the name of sweet Jesus, we do ask. Amen. I want to give you some background on the author of this chapter of Psalm 73. The author's name is Asaph. He was one of the three song leaders of the temple of his day. He was given the responsibility for the music and the praise worship in the temple. It'd be a fair assessment to say that this was a God-fearing man. This was a man who wanted nothing more than the services in the temple to go well and it be a pleasant aroma into God's presence. This would be the type of man who his whole life has been devoted to the service and to the temple of Almighty God. But he developed a problem. He developed a problem as he began to survey the land that was around about the temple. We see in Psalm 73 that he had begun to see things happening outside the temple that just didn't seem right. He had begun to see how God's people, godly people, those who come to the temple, those who come to worship God, those whose hearts were fully set to do what God would have them to do, he began to see them as becoming sick. He began to see them always, it seemed like they were always struggling for money. It seemed like those loved ones were dying away. And it just seemed like all the time that his hands were always holding the hands of those loved ones left behind. And yet as he surveyed the land and he seen all the godly people seem like they're suffering and all the godly people are going through these trials and tribulations, he looked around and seen those who had no regard for God seem like they were prospering. Those who never darkened the door of the temple or the house of God seem like they just go right through life unmolested. They go through life unchallenged, I guess if you will. They go through life and they get the good high-paying jobs, those jobs where every time you go in there, they got their feet up, kicked back on the phone, right? He began to see all those things. It seemed like the wicked were living out the high cotton And the godly folks were in the short, weeded up cotton. This man is just like many of us in our churches today. You look around in this world and it seems like Satan is blessing those who have nothing to do with God. It seems like he's trying to trip us up. And yet, it seems like God's folks are suffering. It seems like God's folks are struggling. It seems like God's people are the ones who's always getting sick, who are always... There's a reason for it. Amen. There's times we have... There's crosses that God's folks have to bear. Understand that. I'm not challenging God's authority today by no means. But I want you to understand tonight, and I don't want to step on my message but through just the introduction, but understand this first and foremost. We go through trials and tribulations that we might win the souls of the lost that are out there. The things going on in your life, God's allowing it to give you a witness to reach somebody in this world. God's giving you an opportunity to reach somebody that could never be reached through somebody else. Know this also, that those wicked people, those folks who never darken the door of the house of God, who have nothing to do with God, have nothing to do with His Word, and don't want anything to do with Him at all, don't want anything to do with you. Know this, they're living it up now. The day's coming. Notice what I said in verse 17. He says, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood therein. They're living it up today. Tomorrow it's not going to fare so well for them. But I want you to know, if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves in the very same place that one of the song leaders of the temple found himself in. How many of us have ever wondered why God took a loved one from us? How many of us have ever asked why we lost that job that we had? Why? How many of us have ever asked, Lord, why do we go through these trials and these tribulations? Why do we have this financial hardship? Have you ever asked yourself that? Have you ever laid in bed at night and wondered and worried about where the money for the light bill is coming from? If I was to survey the crowd tonight, I'd get a lot of yays. I'll be honest with you. I've worked a job where I worked 15 hours a week trying to feed two kids and a wife and pay all the bills. That wasn't enough. Amen. That wasn't enough. There's a lot of gray hairs in this head that wasn't here just a year ago because of the strain and the stress of worrying if the oil field's fixing to collapse. But the problem is, as we begin to look around, when you start looking around, you start seeing how everybody else is faring. You need to be worrying about you and yours and yours and God. That's all you need to worry about. Have you ever asked yourself or asked God or laid in bed at night thinking about why our health is diminishing and those who never darken the house of God never seem to have any trouble? Why did my grandmother have to have Alzheimer's disease and a godly woman? I'd never heard her say a cross word to anybody. Even my granddaddy, which he was a cantankerous old man, about all she could ever say, now Charles, that's enough. Bless God. Not even a cross word to her husband that I know of. And yet God struck her and took her mind. She's been out away from us for over 10 years now. And I don't understand it, but one thing I do is I accept it. It's God's will, and it was a cross that she had to bear. There's four things I want us to learn from tonight out of this psalm, just four. There's a deviation, there's a deliberation, there's a revelation, and then there is a rededication. You see, there's a couple, several things that we need to understand. Asaph addressed this message to God-fearing people to warn us, not allow our hearts to slip and our feet to slip away from the house of God. And that brings me to the first one, the deviation. The leaving of God's ways. The leaving of God's ways, the deviation of the course. Look with me in verse 2. It says, but as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. We see here that his mind is already starting to take a different path. He says, but as for me, my feet were almost gone. You see, the problem that he had begun, as every night as he lay down at night, or even when he was at the house of God, his mind was continually on the problems of life. And he began to contemplate these things that are going on, and he was sitting there and he was beginning to question, what am I doing? Why am I doing the things that I'm doing, and yet God's people are suffering? I bet you, if I was a betting man, you're sitting there under the same assumptions today. I promise you, and you say, how you know that? Because I was that guy. I've sat there in the bed looking up at the ceiling and just wondering, just thinking about why God's people suffer. Why do they have to suffer all the time? Why does it always seem to happen to me? Why am I always passed over for the promotions? Why have I always missed those pay raises? Why are those things happening to me? Or why are they happening to God's people? And I'll be honest with you, it hadn't been that long ago. You're on dangerous ground when those things are happening. We see here that possibly this man was ready to quit the job or the honor that he was doing in the temple, as leaving the temple and going back and going out into the world. We see this man ready to forsake all that he knew. It's possible that this man was ready to just to drop and leave the faith. That's why he said over there, "Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency." We see the man questioning the very core of what he believed. Let me tell you something tonight. God is good. Amen. God is good. There's things go on in our lives that we don't understand. There's things going on in the lives of our neighbors and our loved ones that we can't understand, because God said, my ways are higher than your ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. Thank God that's so. Amen. I'm glad I serve a God that doesn't think like me, because I'll be honest with you, I'm not very long-suffering with a bunch of foolishness. Amen. I'm not. And I've got just the kind of manners to tell you so. But I thank God that He is so long-suffering to us that He'll continue to deal with us. I thank God for His grace. I thank God for His mercy. Because if it wasn't for His grace and it wasn't for His mercy, I wouldn't be saved today. You think about that. 13.5 years God dealt with my heart. I believe as a young child, when I was baptized and still lost, that God was dealing with me then. But I got in with the cool crowd, because all the kids my age were jumping back there and getting baptized, and everything was good, right? So I wanted to be a part of those things. I guess you'd say that's a good peer pressure in a way. But in a bad way, I was lost for 13 years till God showed me that I was wrong. We see here in this psalm that his heart had begun to wander. We see my steps had well nigh slipped. We see here that this man, as he began to dwell on these things, he began to go further and further and further away from the Word of God, and further away from the things that are godly. It's sheer speculation, but just knowing human nature, knowing myself, he had probably quit studying the Word of God. He had probably suffered or even stopped praying to God Almighty. And now he has begun to question God. Those three things right there are just like a snowball. Those three things. Let me challenge you. You stop reading your Word. You stop reading the Bible. You'll find your prayer life will start getting shorter and shorter and shorter. You'll find that your temper I start getting quicker and quicker and with more degrees, I guess you would say. And before long, you're not studying the Word of God, you're not praying, your tongue is taken over, your heart is as hard as it can be, and you're about as callous as you've ever seen. It doesn't take long, about 3 months. You say, brother, how you know that? Because that was me. That was me. We see here that his emotions had begun to take over his life. Look with me in Psalm 73, verse 3. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. He says, for I was envious. Why on earth would you be envious at the foolish? These folks don't believe in God. They're getting all their blessings now. They're living high on the hog now. Let them go. But tell them the day's coming. We have to warn them. I've stood here and preached a sermon on heaven and hell. Listen, hell's for real. Man, those flames are real. Amen. I promise you, we heard about the rich man and Lazarus this morning in Sunday school. If I was a wager man, I bet you that rich man come right here and say, you don't want to go to that horrible place. According to the Scriptures, that's what he said. Man, hell is real. We all love to talk about heaven and how glorious it's going to be. Man, there's more references to hell than there is to heaven. Why is that? Because your mind can't contemplate how great heaven is, but your mind can contemplate how horrible hell is. We like to talk about how horrible life is here on this earth, how hot it is down here in the south. It doesn't compare to the brimstone that is boiling in the lake of fire that's going on right now, that many of our loved ones of old are sitting down there in the flames burning up. The Bible says hell enlarges herself every day to accommodate the wicked. It has to grow. It has to build. Man, why is not the kingdom of heaven doing that? Because we're sitting on the pew doing nothing. I'm guilty. Paul said he was the chief of sinners. It's the only wrong thing that was spoken in the Bible. Amen. That's because he didn't know me. Because he didn't know me. Brings me to my second point this afternoon. The deliberation. The weighing of circumstances. The weighing of circumstances. Now let's look at, there's two different people here I want us to look at. First, we're going to look at the wicked. Always take the bad first, right? We always take that bad medicine first, right? The wicked. There's no suffering in their death. Look with me in verse 4. It says, for there are no bands in their death. We see these people, as they begin to, they die peacefully. That's what Asaph is saying right here. They just lay down and they go to sleep and they never wake up. But let me tell you something, when they wake they up in hell, they know that there's something different. Amen. I tell you, those Muslims who are blowing themselves up, they're waking up to somebody lied to me. Amen. Dr. Billy Graham said one of the greatest harvest fields that are out there is in the Church of the Living God. Man, I don't know about that. I know I'm saved. I pray all y'all are. But all I do know is we need to get busy. Every day that rolls by, we're one day closer to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whether you believe in the imminent coming of Christ or you believe there's a certain time that's allotted, it doesn't matter. God's sovereign. He can come when He wants to. Amen. He can come when He wants to. He can tip those dominoes. All them things can lay down in one night. You wake up, Jesus is coming. Amen. But know this. When He does come and He does call His church up and we are gone, bless God, if you're still here, it's going to get bad for you. It's going to be horrible. The Bible says in that day men shall seek death and death shall flee from them. Let me tell you something. When it says no suffering in their death over here in the south, there'll be plenty suffering in their death on that side of it. There's another thought. They have their health. Look with me in verse 4, the latter part of it says, but their strength is firm. And in other words, these wicked people, when they do die, there's no suffering, there's no anguish, there's no pain. They just slip out into eternity. And when they are alive, it seems like their strength is with them forevermore. It seems like they never get sick. They never lay on the bed wasting away with cancer and all those things. Their strength is always there. In verse 5, we see that they are completely unmolested. Psalm 73 verse 5 says, they are not troubled as other men, neither are they plagued like others. Now, I was praying over here a while ago that we'd sing Father Alone. That song goes right along with this message. Like, no matter of fact, it's the inspiration to that message. But as you read the verses of that, it ties with Psalm 73 like no other, like I've never seen. I believe that the author of Father Alone, is, by the way, is 310. But, yeah, I'm lobbying, so y'all bear with me. No, seriously though, they correlate together so well. They really do. I challenge you, the next time you open that book, to read the words. Read them. The wicked here live their life completely unmolested. It seems like nobody's knocking on their door to say, where's payment at? It seems like nobody is knocking on their door going, man, we're going to take your vehicle if you don't have some money, right? We're fixing to cut your power bill off if you don't come up with some money. You can write us a check. I can write you a check all day long, but you're going to send Brother Mark to come get me if I do. No. We also see that these wicked people, they are materialistic. Verse 7 of our text says, their eyes stand out with fatness, and they have more than their heart could wish. This means right here that there's nothing non-attainable to these people. That it seems like that their wealth is just overflowing wealth. All they could ever wish for, they have. If they do wish for it, they go get it, right? There's one more thing I want you to notice about these people. Verse 11, they speak against God. Man, what a dangerous ground that they're in. They're speaking against God. It said in verse 11, it says, and they say, how doeth God know? And it's their knowledge in the Most High. Man, what a horrible place, what a horrible thing to say against my God. The God that spoke and the heavens were made. The God that said, let there be light, and there was light. Go and study Job for a moment when Job was having his pity party and he began to question God, and God said, where were you when I set the foundations of the world? Where were you as God began to school Job? And I'll tell you this, when you start having a pity party in yourself and you begin to doubt God and you begin to question God, I promise you God's going to set you straight. Because He's going to begin to tell you, where were you when I said, let there be light? Where were you when I created the heavens and the earth? Can you imagine for just a moment the God that we have in our little small mind as He swung the stars where they are? Have you ever wondered how this old ball that we walking around on today that is somewhere in the vicinity of 25,000 miles in circumference, and that thing is spinning, and it's spinning at over 1,000 miles per hour. And that's why we have in 24 hours, daylight to daylight, right? This is yes. That's right. Have you ever drove down the road with an unbalanced tire? That thing could just beat you off the road. You know what I'm talking about? Have you ever wondered why we move a mountain over here and we go and set it over here? Or we go over here and we dig this big, massive lake and we move the dirt over here and build a road, and yet this old ball just keeps spinning just like it is. Kicked on its axis just perfect to sustain life. You ever wonder? Because God's got it on His finger. Man, we serve an awesome God. Man, we look at hurricanes and we think, oh, that's the hand of God. No, that's God sneezed. Amen. No, seriously. That's how great our God is. He said, let there be light, and there was light. He slung the stars into space that they were. He created the Milky Way that we like to call it. He created this thing. Have you ever seen the pictures of that telescope that's still going? The Hubble. Have y'all seen some of the greatest creations God created way on out there we can't see? Man, my mind just, man, God's great, right? And it pales in comparison to what He has in store for us. When I began to hear people, they think they see something. They think they see the new Jerusalem coming. God's not going to show the lost folks before He sees me. Shows me, right? They ain't going to see it. No. That brings me to the righteous. What I speak of last Wednesday night, yea, those that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall what? Suffer persecution. That's 1 Timothy, I believe it's 1 Timothy 3:12. Listen, we're going to have a hard time in this world, amen? It's coming. I could skip this whole part of the message. Listen to me. There's things that go on in our lives, we just have to buck up and take it, amen? It's things God allows to go on in our life. Now, You say, well, there's financial hardships. Bless God, you probably borrowed it on yourself. I was that guy. There was a vehicle I was driving, and I drove it about 2.5 years. Said, you know what? I want a new one. I'd go get a new one upside down, right? Then I drive that one another 2.5 years. I go get another one. Now, upside down, before you know it, you own 2 vehicles and riding around in one, right? I see a lot of giggling. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Listen, we make the financial hardships on ourselves. I understand there's hardships going on. You lose your job, things go wrong, you get hurt, and you get behind. I understand that. But if you'll sit down and you'll think about it, when was the last time you prayed, said, God, Lord, we need a vehicle. Will you provide one for us? I'm riding around in a truck out there right now. I didn't pray. The one before that, I did. And I'm still kicking myself because there wasn't nothing wrong with the one I got rid of. Amen. The house that I'm in now, I prayed about it. God provided a way, and it's paid off. Bless God. Listen, the financial hardships that are going on in our lives right in this day and time is because we didn't pray for God's direction in our lives. We're looking at building some chicken houses so I can come home from offshore. But bless God, to know this, we've been praying a long time. And the whole prayer was, Lord, if you want us to have them, open the door. If you don't, close the door. I don't care one way or another. You're going to get the glory. That's been my prayer from the very beginning. I don't really care one way or another. Yeah, I'd love to come home. But sometimes God has me stuck out there for a reason. There's somebody that needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ that I can't reach here. And I'll tell you this, you might be stuck in a dead-end job. You might be stuck where you don't want to be. But bless God, if you'll be faithful and you'll witness to people, you'll finally come across that one that God has put you there to witness to. And when you do witness to Him, God will move you to where He wants you. Amen. The righteous. We see here that in verse 10 that they are bled dry through taxes, through death. Their wealth is completely drained. He says, therefore, his people return hither, and the waters of a full cup are wrung out of them. We see here unseen fruit of our labor in the service of God. Notice with me in verse 13 says, verily, have I cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency? Got a couple things right here. It's easy for us to get discouraged. It's easy for us to become dismayed when we don't see the fruit bearing of our hard labors. Amen. Man, I tell you what, I've been preaching for a long time, and I've been lucky to see 9 people saved in one night. That's it. I preached my heart out of just short of doing backflips like Billy Sunday up here, and I get through, and we have the invitation, and I see people sitting just like this. Move me if you can. Been teaching for almost 10 years to the glory of God, teaching Sunday school, witnessing to people, working out there offshore, living a godly life before a lost and dying world. And I haven't seen what I'd love to see. I'd love to see a whole congregation down here on their faces crying and weeping and getting right with God in a revival service take place. But God hasn't allowed that yet. It's easy to get disappointed. It's easy to get discouraged. But I tell you what, as Brother Talley used to say, you got to keep on keeping on. You can't give up. You got to keep pressing toward that mark, the mark of the high calling of Jesus Christ. You got to keep on keeping on. I bet I've got some Sunday school teachers that are here that really want to see people saved. I bet you I have. I hate to keep using the word bet you, but I'd love to think we've got people here that's been praying for this church, to see this church grow like it once was, to see the glory as it once had. There are people here, the teachers that want to see those young kids coming to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And me, as I preach the gospel, I want to see people saved. I want to see God glorified. I want to see lives changed by the Lord Jesus Christ, not by my preaching. At the end of the day, I'm just preaching His Word. I'm just rehashing what He's already said. You've seen that through my preaching, right? Let's go here. Let's go read over here. But yet, we're not seeing anybody saved. We're not seeing people who've been at aught with another coming and hugging one another and saying, man, I was wrong. We're not seeing that. We're not going to see a revival service till people finally set aside that pride of life and turn loose of that pew and come down here and get right with God. Well, one thing about it, you're going to hear. You're going to hear the glory of God. You're going to hear the blood of Jesus Christ. And you're going to hear me tell you that you're a sinner and need to be saved. Amen. I'm not going to sugarcoat nothing. I'm going to tell you the truth. And bless God, we're all dirty. We're all dirty in the sight of God. It's the only difference between me and that murderer on the street down there is I'm saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. I spoke of thumbing our nose at God and sticking our nose up in the air at the lost people. Bless God, I was no different than them. God just dealt with me and I said, Lord, have mercy on me. That's the only difference. We also see with the righteous here as a constant bombardment. In verse 14 says, for all the day long have I been plagued. We see here also in verse 14 that there's a never-ending correction. In the latter part of that verse 14 it says, and chastised every morning. We also see in verse 15 that a south is struggling with wavering faith. If I say, I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against a generation of thy people. This man was struggling with a heart problem. This man was struggling with the devil has already tied him up in the knots. He already had his one foot out the door and the other one on a banana peel. This man was struggling. He was trying to hold on to a godly life and he was on his way out the temple. How many of us are there today? 6 months ago, was that you? You had one foot out that door ready to go somewhere else. Man, turn loose of the world. Tell Satan to get behind me. The Bible says, submit yourselves to God and resist the devil. Right? What does it also say about that passage of Scripture? And the devil will flee from you, right? Look, I'm not here to cause any division in the church. If anything, I want to see God's people get right with one another. Amen. I want to see God's people lifting one another up. Nothing make me any madder than be at down there at Walmart and hearing church folks talk about other church folk. Man, I'll get fighting mad. It ain't even my church. Amen. You know why? You know why that is? Because there's people listening that don't come to the house of God. That's why. If we're that holy city set up on a hill, what kind of witness are we setting before the lost and dying world? If we want them to come up here, they're surely not coming now, right? They're going down there to First Baptist or Lake First Baptist or wherever, but they ain't coming here if you're down there running your church member down. I'll say this. I was asked to go to a church. They were having troubles. That was it was a division in there. It was thick. And I preached on division in the church. And I scolded them, the whole congregation, not just one individual, right? Y'all know how I preach. Cock both barrels and let them have it, right? I did. I let them have it. They hadn't asked me back. They hadn't asked me to come back. But my point is, Satan's forces are united shoulder to shoulder, foot to foot, shield to shield, warring, conquering, doing everything that they can do. Why are we up here bickering? Because somebody's skirt's just a little bit too short. I'm sorry, but God's folks ought to be better than that. Amen? That's right. We see Asaph here, he's struggling with wavering faith. He had seen the trials of the faithful. He had seen the faithful sick, dying, poor, and destitute. He had seen, no doubt, he had held the hands of the loved ones left behind. Or maybe even knelt and prayed with them as they cried and wept over their loved one. But he had enough respect. He had enough respect to hold these things in his heart until God could show him the way. Look with me in the latter part. He says, if I would say thus, if I would say, I would speak thus, behold, I should offend against a generation of thy people. We see here that he held his tongue. Even though he was thinking these things, he held his tongue. Because why? Because the church is greater than ourselves. Amen? It is a conglomeration of people coming up here, of true believers coming to worship the true and the living God. It ain't about you, amen? It's not about your feelings that's out here on the sleeves. It's about a greater thing. It's about glorifying God, amen? Listen, if I wore my feelings out here on my sleeves, I'd have give up a long time ago, just down the road over there, and been somewhere else. But bless God, there was something driving me in my heart, just like it was the South, that said, don't give up, don't leave. I've got it worked out. I just had to take a few kicks in the teeth, right? I had to bite my tongue till I just about bit it off. But bless God, I've done it because of the greater good, because I wanted to see young people saved. I wanted to see the church grow. I wanted to see the glory of God. And when I walked through those doors, I wanted to be in God's presence. Amen. Listen to me. If you want to come through those doors and you want to feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, there's some things that's got to be happening in your life and in the lives of this congregation. Number one, you need to be at home before you get here on your knees in prayer and asking God, visit us today. Number two is you need to get right with God before you ever come. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, me. I didn't hear a whole lot of amens there. You need to pray that God would forgive you of the sin in your life that day before you ever come here. You ought to be prepared to meet God when you walk through those doors. You say, wait a minute, brother. God's in my heart. He's with me always. You're absolutely right. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever come into a church house or a revival service or a tent service that there was something different when you walk through the doors? I have. I've seen the Holy Spirit swoop across a congregation before. I know that sounds Pentecostal. Y'all don't throw rocks at me. No, seriously. I have. I've seen the Holy Spirit move across a congregation of about 40 people. And I've seen 9 people saved one night. This thing's serious. You know why? Because the missionaries that were there were on their knees in prayer day and night praying that God would move that congregation. I promise you, if we'd do the same thing here, you'd see these pews fill up. I promise you. I promise you. I can't be any more plain. Then that brings me to the revelation, a time when we are spoken to by the Almighty Himself. Look with me in verse 17. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I therein. Listen to me today. Don't hear anything else. We have to suffer. I know I've already spoken. We've got crosses that we have to bear. There's things we have to endure as the children of God. But the lost people are living the best days of their life right now. The days to come, when they pass into the next life, it's not going to be roses. Amen. It's not going to be kick back and talking on the cell phone. Oh no. My Bible says that there will be gnashing of teeth. There will be moaning and groaning. There will be the pungent smell of fire and brimstone, the smoke as it overclouds hell through all the smoke. And I'd love to think or envision the smell of burning flesh, but there's no flesh there. Can't imagine the pungent smell of suffering. But that's what hell's about. There's no joy ever. I was witnessing to a guy one time. As a matter of fact, that was right after I got saved. I was attacking hell with a water pistol. We were just talking about those two ladies this while ago. A friend of mine I worked with every day was telling him about Jesus Christ. He said, man, I don't want to go to heaven. I said, well, look at the Lord, why not? He said, because nobody I know will be there. Man, I don't care. Amen. Let them go. Me and you will be up there singing, right? I've had people tell me, well, I don't believe that way. Well, that don't change the facts. I've had people tell me that they believe Satan and Satan himself will receive forgiveness for the things done in this life and be able to come into the kingdom of God. And I'm like, oh my goodness, where does this doctrine come from? Listen, we as the children of God need to understand just how holy our God really is. We ought to understand just how important it is to try to live that godly life. Isaiah chapter 6, I spoke of it this morning. We have to see ourselves as sinful creatures. We have to see ourselves in need of God's enduring mercy and God's everlasting forgiveness of sin. And Isaiah 6 verse 1 says, "In the year of King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne high and lifted up, and His train filled the temple." In verse 5, let me read that whole passage of Scripture. High and lifted up, and His train had filled the temple. And above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings, and with twain He covered His face, and with twain He covered His feet, and with twain He did fly. In other words, he wasn't righteous enough to look upon God. He wasn't righteous enough to even allow His feet to be pointed toward God. And he had six wings, but He could only use two of them to fly. Amen? That's just how holy our God really is. Amen? And we think we can walk on the blood of Jesus Christ, or we think we can take God's name in vain, and He ain't going to do a thing about it. Let me tell you something. Something's going to be done. Amen? Now, I'm fixing the metal here, so y'all bear with me. You go back and you study your Bible, and I have yet to find where God destroyed a nation or destroyed a town where what was the last straw? Homosexuality, right? We were the last straw with God. We've turned our backs on Israel. By the way, we're not being blessed anymore. Debt upon debt upon debt upon debt, right? The Bible says if we don't honor His covenant, He'll appoint terror over us. We got y'all forgive me, but we got a bunch of morons in Washington. It don't matter which side of the aisle they're on, they're just bickering like a bunch of two-year-olds. We don't have statesmen anymore. People there for the common good. What's the common good? The United States of America, right? No, they're just worried about me and mine. Just like everybody else in this nation. Instead of worrying about what God thinks about this nation. You wonder why we're falling. You wonder why we're faltering. You wonder why our position in the world is where it's at today. Because we got a leader who says we're not a Christian nation anymore. Why does a person like that even there anyway? Because the church has lost her voice. We had men that would stand up and say, "That ain't right." And we had politicians shut their mouth. Amen. Whether you liked him, whether you didn't, Brother Jerry Farwell, that passed away several years ago, was about the biggest voice that we had. He's gone. Nobody stepped up to take his place. Nobody. We let things come into here that ought not be here. But I'll tell you this. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed, the United States will be destroyed too if we keep allowing this homosexuality to run rampant. That's the last straw. It's the last straw with God. It's always been that way. We have got it to word murder. We call abortion, it's choice. No, it's murder. We call sinful behaviors on our television, we call it entertainment. But at the end of the day, it's iniquity. We celebrate greed and we call it capitalism. By the way, I'm not an anti-capitalist. I believe you work honest days, you ought to get honest days pay. Amen. That's right. That don't matter if it's a woman, man, child, whatever. You work honest days work, you ought to get honest days pay. But my whole point is we're celebrating sin and we're glorifying it as we turn around. And now we've made... Now we're intolerant because we don't tolerate those who we don't associate with, right? They don't want anything to do with us, but they want us to glorify their sin. Man, it's wrong. Wrong is wrong. You can't take two wrongs and make a right. Amen? I'm almost done, so y'all bear with me. We see here that He has given insight to what will happen to the wicked. They will perish. Sooner or later, they will perish. Verse 18 says, "Surely thou didst set them in slippery places and castest them down into destruction. They will receive the due that is to them in God's time. How they brought into desolation, as in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors. That's verse 19. Their prosperity can't deliver them. We see here in this day and time, people think their wealth can deliver them. They think their wealth can get them out of... Let me tell you something. God can strike you with an aneurysm and you gone. Amen. It's over with. God can strike you with a stroke and you're forever changed. Amen. God could strike you to where you hit them brakes on the way home and they go to the floor and bless God, you go meet your maker just like that. Or you can be driving down the road and that 18-wheeler tire runs off the wheel and there he comes right on top of you. I've got a former cousin-in-law. That's what happened to him. Man, this life is just a vapor. Here today and gone tomorrow. The wicked's got what's coming to them. But I'll tell you this, we continue to glorify sin. We've got something coming to ourselves too. There's a couple things I want us to see here. We see here that as we look at a sow, we should be given a new lease on life. We see the struggles of a sow here. We should have a new lease on life. Number one is we should praise God in all things. God should get the praise for all things in our life. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 says, "And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasures in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecution, in distress for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." We need to understand we're going through trials and tribulations for the glory of God. That God is trying to work great things through these infirmities, through these persecutions, through these trials and tribulations. Not only that, here's a problem that we have in America today. We need to learn to be content with what we are given. We need to learn to be content with what we are given. God's blessed us beyond our wildest imagination. Amen. Psalms 37:16 says, "A little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked." 1 Timothy 6:6 says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." Proverbs 15:16 says, "Better is little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and troubles therewith." Philippians 4:11 says, "Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content." Man, the Bible's full of those. Amen. God's blessed us. Whether you want to continue to look out there what other people have. Listen, you'll never keep up with the Joneses. Amen. You'll never keep up with them. Let them go amount all the debt they can. Let them have it. Amen. You live to the glory of God. There's another problem that we have in the church today. Be faithful at what capacity God allows you to serve Him. Listen to me. We are all the body of Christ. You might be the big toe into the body of Christ, but be the best big toe you can. Amen? You might be the arm in the church of the living God. Be the best arm you can. And that goes to whether you're teaching Sunday school or you're doing devotions or you're up here preaching the gospel or you're cleaning the toilets. Do it to the glory of God. That means study. That means study the curriculum. That means be able to up here to answer the questions that the people may have. Man, do it to the best of your ability. Too many times we have people in the Church of the Living God, "Well, I don't want to do that. I want to go and do this." Well, God didn't tell you to go over there. God wants you where you are, or you'd already be there. I'll be honest with you. I didn't want to preach. But I'm here. The rededication. I'll try to hurry. Rededication. The resolve to follow the Lord. Look with me in our text, verse 23. It says, "Nevertheless, I am continually with thee, and thou hast holden me with thy right hand." We see Asaph is given a new way of life, a new way of thinking. And verse 28 says, "But it's good for me to draw near to God, and I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare thy works." He had found new courage to stand upon the rock, the Lord. Verse 26, he says, "My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is my strength and my of my heart and my portion forever." In closing tonight, we see the temptations all around us. Many times we see those who care nothing for God live a life that we could only dream of. That doesn't change the fact that they're lost and undone. That doesn't change the fact that they need Jesus just like we do. It doesn't change the fact Jesus loves us all. Song leader, pianist, if you'll come, we'll have an invitation.